afternoon. My name is Kate, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this keynote speech from Serge Maginot from Tempo Secure, who will be talking to you about securing the hardware in connected objects and not just the software. So this conference is a very special conference because not only is Serge a Minalogic member, which is very important, taking part in the Minalogic business meetings, but we're also sharing this conference with our partners from Silicon Saxony during their Silicon Saxony day. So we have participants coming from another event joining us for this special conference. So welcome everybody. I'm gonna switch myself off. If you have any questions for Serge, don't hesitate to put them in the chat tab. So the question tab doesn't work, little information there. Put them in the chat tab on your right-hand side of your screen and we'll get to them at the end. So we'll leave the floor to Serge and thank you very much.
Thank you, Kate. Thank you, everyone. It's my pleasure to have this talk with you about hardware secure enclaves, you know, why they're critical for IoT security and what is coming next. I have divided the talk in three sections. You know, first, I have a couple of slides to introduce Tempo Secure, our company. Then the second section is about the secure elements. Why are they critical, so important for IoT security in particular? And the last and not least section is what comes next? You know, what evolution are we foreseeing for these secure elements? So, Tempo Secure is a company we started 13 years ago. We have one important statement. We believe that you cannot have security without secure hardware, namely these secure elements that are proven to be resistant against all state-of-the-art cyber attacks, such as side channel attacks. So at Tempo Secure, we deliver, our customers are chip design companies, and we deliver to them a secure element IP core and secure software libraries that enable the highest level of security for the chip, for the SoC, including this IP, typically that enable to target security certification, such like common criteria EL5+ certification. On the top, on the IP, we also offer additional expert services to ensure the security certification of our customer chips, as well as the secure life cycle of these chips. So it's, as I said, you know, it's actually 14 years ago, time is flying. Anyway, that created Tempo in Montbonneau near Grenoble, France. We named it Tempo Secure since 2010, where we decided really to focus on security. We started as a chip design companies, you know, and we develop our own secure microcontroller chip with NFC and contact interfaces and secure flash for the smart card market, banking and ID governmental application with a fabless chip model. Okay. In this context, we got the certification, common criteria EL5+, and EMVCO certification of these microcontroller chips. We learned a lot. We developed our IP, our expertise. I'll talk about this certification later in the presentation. Common criteria L5+, that's the level of certification you'll get for the chips that are in governmental documents like passport. EMVCO stands for Europay, MasterCard, and Visa, so you can guess that's related to the banking application. Starting in 2016, we decided to look at other markets, and especially the IoT markets. And because our first early adopters on this market were a chip design company, we decided to change our business model and to adopt an IP business model, but leveraging all the IP and expertise we developed in the previous model. And the idea was basically to introduce our secure element core present in our smart card chips to put it in the SoC of our customers with the same guarantee on quality. We had our first design win end of 2018, so a little bit more than 2 years now. And we are currently completing a first certification of a customer SoC integrating our chip. So, you know, today what we provided are IP and services. I'm not going to enter into details, but we provide secure hardware IP, typically secure element cores, design service on the top of that for secure hardening, you know, your design. Provide also secure software library like secure bootloader, crypto library that are also at the common criteria 5 plus certification level. Software services, and last but not least, security services. We can handle for our customers the certification on their ship completely, meaning managing the relationship with the certification labs. And we can also provide key management operation services. Our main differentiator with other IP vendors is that really we focus on the hardware secure element as to implement what we call the root of trust. And our IP is mainly a family of secure element core, TASIC. I'll make some reference to that in the later talk. And the fact also that we design our own chips give us, you know, the expertise to guarantee the certification to our customers, which is really unique on this market. And we have, as I already said, we offer associated services on that. Okay, and finally, what I can say, we have been very happy recently to be nominated as one of the 11 winners of the French government's Great Cybersecurity Challenge for the French people, Grand Défi Cybersécurité. I know that we are the only company in the Auvergne-Rhône-Alpes region of having this grant. And we are in this context working on a interesting project called IMRC, Integrated Monitoring and Recovery Components. That's actually the project in which we develop a new version of secure element that I'm going to talk about in the last section of my talk. Okay, that's it for Tiempo. So let's come to the core of the presentation. Why are secure elements critical for IoT security? You know, it's the first step. So first of all, what is a secure element? A secure element is basically a hardware safe box. You know, all analogies are limited, but at least this is the best we can find. So a secure element, you have different names in the literature and, you know, in the commercial offering, but basically you can call it secure element, hardware security enclave, hardware security module. Although this one is also used for different things. Hardware root of trust, some mentioned tamper resistance elements. That's all the same. It's basically a system or a subsystem, I would say, with hardware resources dedicated to the protection of secrets and the execution of sensitive and secure software. So a subsystem which includes typically a secure CPU executing secure code, a crypto accelerator. You know, as you know, the encryption algorithm can be very time consuming, so you need to accelerate their execution. Security sensors and secured memories, that's a subsystem implementing this hardware safe box, I would say. This concept has been historically introduced in smart card and ID government documents, you know, with the small smart card chip that you see. You know, whether it is for banking cards, for your IC, for your SIM cards, or for your passports, it's more or less the same chip that you have inside. In all cases, it's protected against the cyber attacks at the highest level of security, including the physical attacks, I would say, especially the physical attacks such as side channel attacks. It is certified in this domain, in this market. All the chips that you have in banking cards, passport are certified, which means that they pass through an evaluation, a technical evaluation by independent labs. It's an independent evaluation done by these certified labs and certified by national cybersecurity agencies. In France, you have the ANSI. In Germany, you have the BSI, who certify the chip. So there is an independent evaluation and certification of the security level. And typically, there are at least at common criteria 4 plus and above, and EMVCO for the payment. So that's a secure element. Again, it's a hardware safe box. So why do we need a hardware safe box? First, you know, a strong statement I want to make here is that protection against cyber attack by software only is not enough. You know, just to make it short, that doesn't work. You know, because at the bottom, what you have in your, when you want to secure a system or an algorithm, you need to encrypt data, encrypt the code that you use. That means that if you need to encrypt, you need to have keys, encryption keys. These are an example of secrets. Now, with today's techniques such as side channel attacks, if the hardware does not include security countermeasures at the hardware level, you can be sure that such secrets like encryption key can be retrieved, can be found using this kind of attacks if you don't have, you know, secure hardware to protect them. So that's to explain why you need hardware to implement your security at that level. Now, why a safe box? Why a subsystem inside your system? One might say, okay, let's secure the whole system on chip, the whole design. That's probably the best solution. That theoretically could be the best solution, but actually it's too complex. You know, the SoC design are now too complex to be secured completely. When you think about a typical SoC design project, well, you have many engineers, you have many user requirements, and you have other priorities driving such SoC projects. You know, different application usage you need to implement. You have also all the PPA, performance support area constraints, and last but not least, time to market. Additionally, you know, the level of expertise you need, the security expertise you need to really secure your SoC is very rare. You know, at finding engineers that have this level of expertise to secure the whole SoC is a complex, is difficult, if not impossible. So a more realistic approach is to let one specific component or sub-block of the SoC designed by security specialists handle the security of the data and code. This is the notion of secure element embedded into the SoC. Okay. So I mentioned a couple of times these physical attacks called side channel attacks. You know, what are these side channel attacks and why are they important? Well, side channel attacks easily can extract secrets, like again, encryption keys, from a chip through the analysis of physical parameters such as, you know, the supply current, the way the power consumption of your chip varies, the execution time, you know, for operations that are time dependent, but what we try to avoid typically, and through electronic emission. So most of the advanced side channel attacks require physical access to connected objects, not all, but the most powerful. So that might be a restriction, you know, on how to use these side channel attacks, but actually it can still affect many markets, especially in the IoT space, if you think about that. All consumer products, industry sensors, for example, that are deployed in industry sites, energy grids, medical, telecom, automotive. Well, many of these markets have their objects accessible, you know, therefore attackable. So it's mandatory today, really, to be protected against these such channel attacks. I'm not going to give a lot of details about these different families of side channel attacks. You know, you can find literature on the web, no problem. There have been a couple of famous examples of such attacks, very different, by the way, side channel attacks, the famous Meltdown and Spectre attacks, what we call cache-based attacks on modern microprocessors. That was, you know, that these attacks were able to get access to unauthorized memory accesses. So in this case, of course, such processors are secure, but they do not include the notion of secure element here. It's the same processor that executes both secure and non-secure application, which, you know, there was a flaw here that has been corrected since then. Another example is a chip used in a Google Titan security key. You know, you can find information about these attacks at the site of Ninja Lab, who did that. In that case, it was actually a secure element chip, so that's interesting. That was certified, but it was what we call a legacy secure element chip, not at the state of the art. So that's a general comment, a limitation. You know, even if your chip is certified at the highest level, it is certified for a certain period of time. So you better, your system, you better keep your security countermeasures up to date with the state of the art of the attacks. That's a general statement. So as I mentioned in the beginning, secure elements have been first introduced as standalone chip. You know the form factor of smart cards. You know, but you don't know the one inside your passport, but the same same kind of chip. Now you have such secure element available for the IoT market that are small devices, you know, with a limited pad. You can find one in every, you know, all modern smartphones today have such a secure element to implement the payment application. And they are certified. Most of the time, they got the common criteria EL5 plus payment, I mean, at least for the certified application. Here on the slide, you can see the certification, the ANSI certification from one of the chips that we developed at Tiempo some time ago. And again, I already mentioned the typical element that you have inside such a secure element that's always the same. I come back to that later on these elements. So what are the typical applications supported by the secure element chips? Payment, of course, mentioned multiple times. That's what you call the EMV core applets. That's the most well-known and standard payment application. Europay, MasterCard, Visa, all these level, that's the EMV core certification. You have other payment card, of course, virtual credit card, the one you have on your mobile phone that use a secure element or e-purse card. You, of course, have hardware wallets to save cryptocurrencies that also use secure element chips. All the identification application, of course, the SIM cards to authenticate your phone or an object, as we will see later on a cellular network. You have the electronic passport. You also have the web authentication, you know, for remote access through the web to your computer. They use FIDO standard. And then you have other applications that use secure element chips, typically are the anti-cloning, you know, to protect some brands or luxury goods, typically, but also printer cartridge to make sure that the vendors of printers, they like you to use the cartridge of the same brand, of course. You can have such a chip. So one point here, you have different standards for different applications, but at the technical level for security, they all rely more or less on the same technical requirement for security that all more or less comply with common criteria EL4 plus or EL5 plus certification. Okay, so that's the implication you have supported by standalone secure element chip. Where are we going today? Now, today, for us, it's a story that already started for us, Tiempo, that already started some years ago, but it's still new for many companies. The idea is to integrate such secure element chip inside your SoC, not as a companion chip outside your chip. Why? Well, for obvious benefit in terms of cost and reduction, but also to reduce power consumption, to reduce some time to market for the OEMs mainly, and not for the chip providers, of course, but because they have one important additional piece. But basically, it's the idea when you can have one chip instead of two, why not having one chip? It's a general trend. So let's have an integrated secure element, we call it here ISC, that is connected typically as a peripheral as a peripheral inside the system on chip. You know, you have a typical here schematic of such a chip. You have a CPU, you have memories, you have other peripherals, of course, that are application dependent, the secure element, and you have an interface to some external flash. But this is a model we are going to use several times. SoC can, of course, include non-volatile memories, but because some silicon processors do not provide this technology, and also sometimes for cost reason, many SoC developers do not want to embed non-volatile memories into their chips, so they use external flash. And you will see that this, of course, creates potentially weaknesses in terms of security because you access typically the firmware to be executed by the CPU is stored on an external chip. Anyway, this integration of the ISC, of the secure element, allows to support the typical application we mentioned before, but it also allows for new application. Because of the integration, typically the secure boot of the system on chip, secure tests, and other HSM-like cryptographic API, you know, functions. So for the example of secure applet that runs on the first SoCs today that integrate a secure element, This is a list extracted from our website, but this is generic enough. You have, of course, all the connectivity application. I mean, all the objects that include, that are connected to internet, or, no, sorry, that are connected to a cellular network, 5G, LTM, others, and the IoT for the IoT space, they require a modem chip. And you, the system requires a SIM card to authenticate the object on the cellular network. So now, when we can integrate this SIM functionality inside the SoC. That's a SIM software running on an integrated secure element. You have the payment application already mentioned that you find in objects today, web authentication, and automotive market, of course, is introducing specific application like V2X HSM, which is a vehicle to anything protocol communication for the new generation of autonomous cars, or what's available today also is a smart card access. You have a standard to control basically your car, open the doors and so on with your mobile devices. So these are all certified standard application that can run on a secure element that is integrated. Besides that, the fact that the secure element is integrated in the SOC allows you to have additional functionality that are of primary importance for the system on chip. The first one being, of course, a secure boot. Okay, secure boot is today a feature that is implemented in most of the SoC, but it's not necessarily handled by a secure element. Actually, most of the time, it is not. So basically, the only difference here is that because the secure element is so strong in terms of security, is certified common criteria L5+, you have a guarantee that your secret, especially the encryption keys, cannot be retrieved. You know, so you might have a secure boot implemented without that, but then you know, secure boot means decrypting, means keys. If the keys are easily extracted, but at the end you have nothing. So here is the idea: is the secure element can be the companion block of the CPU or CPUs of the SoC to handle their boot. Okay, the SOC CPU boots on the ROM. The ROM code asks the secure element to load the firmware image from the external flash. And then here you enter in a very secure process. I mean, the secure element reads from the flash, check the authenticity of the firmware, decrypts it, and writes it into the RAM. And all of this process has been evaluated by independent expert labs and been certified, so you can be sure that you have the highest level of security. Once the code is safely stored in the RAM, then you know the ROM code jumps to the RAM. It's a secure boot, really made more stronger thanks to the use of integrated secure element. You have additional things you can do when you have that is to have secure output. Basically, you set at the output of your chip the command, the data, only if highly secured authentication has succeeded. You can, and again, this authentication protocol is handled by the secure element, so it gives you guarantee of the validity of the output. Of the validity of the external chips reading this output, I would say, because you have an authentication protocol. You can allow secure test, access to test or debug feature in a secure way, again, handled by the secure element. You can also sign the inputs. For example, if you, for a domotic application, you get commands from your, your door is locked or open. This kind of information, you want to propagate them through the web. You have a way to sign them and to make sure that on the other side, the application of the smartphone has a real data and not something that has been hacked. Again, you use all the power of the secure element, the security to do that. I'm going to pass quickly on that. You can have access to the slide. This is TASIC, I mean, Tempo secure element, but it's actually very generic. You have four main parts. Bottom left, you have a secure CPU with memory protection unit, all the things you can think about. On the bottom right, you typically have a set of standard crypto accelerators for asymmetric and symmetric algorithms, like RSA, ECC, for asymmetric, AES. you have SHA routines. On the bottom, you have a list of security sensors. So this is to be at the level of Komotrek Kitria EL5 plus, like a temperature sensor, glitch detectors, or an active shield. This sensor detects intrusion of a physical attacks. Of course, two random generators are necessary. Top left, you have memories, RAM, ROM. You might have non-volatile memory like OTP. I come back to that. And standard interface to connect typically on the bus of your SoC. But it's a complete subsystem. And in terms of certification, this is what we call the target of evaluation. So this is the sub part of your device that is supposed to be really secured. And the rest of the SoC is actually considered by the evaluator as unsecure, untrustable. And despite all the system must work safely. So typically when you connect that with an external flash, this is how you connect it. The application CPU, the application CPU will typically send commands to the secure element through IPv slave interface, typically. And this secure element will read in a secure way through an external flash, through an HB master interface. Now that brings the point of the communication, the integration of the external flash. In that case, you are obliged to secure the portion of the external flash that stores secure data and secure code. And you must implement a specific protection mechanism called anti-rollback. You don't want any attacker to be able to replace your external flash with another flash or with a previous version of the same flash contents. And this is a mechanism that is implemented in such a device and which is certified as well. So different NVM, non-volatile memory architecture are supported. Like in standalone chips, standalone secure element chip or smart card chip, you can have embedded flash or MRAM and it's available. Or you can use external flash memory, any external flash memories at the expense of ensuring this anti-replay mechanism. Typically, we use for that onboard OTP to mark any flash update. Again, this is a technique that we at Tempo has certified. You have some companies, and especially Winbond, actually is providing some flash chips that are secured, certified, common criteria. And in that case, you don't need to care about anti-rollback mechanism because you have an encrypted, the SOC knows the flash, the way it is encrypted. That's another solution. Okay, I'm sorry for the acceleration, but I see that time is flying and we want to have time for question. So, okay. I hope you still get my slide. Okay. So, Kate, can you just confirm that my slides are still visible?
Yeah, we can see them fine.
Okay. So what's come next? A couple of slides on that. Now that I, promoted the merits of the secure elements, I'm going to tell that, of course, the secure elements have limitations. Okay, as we say, secure elements protect the assets, but actually does not protect the SOC runtime execution. I mean, on the application side, outside the secure element. So it does not prevent, by definition, by construction, the weaknesses on the SOC side, and a malware can still take control of the SOC processor. We say a secure element is like a safe box. Okay. A malware possibly present on the SOC side cannot get the secrets on the secure element. But it can still decide to deny services, to ask for ransom and to use or not the secure element features. That's the problem. Well, that's the limitation, I would say. But the secure element is still a passive component of a SOC, right? So it's a peripheral handling the security, but it's up to the SOC processor to decide to use it or not. So that's the limitation. And what we are developing, the trend today, is to look to assign a more active role, I would say, to the secure element, to an IAC integrated in a SOC to make it an active component. And the idea here is to give control features to the secure element. And in particular, to make him responsible for the access to any external memories and to the boot process. Okay, I'll go quickly over phase two, and then I introduce some innovation we are working on the IMRC project, so I'll come back on that, that goes beyond these new features. So what does it mean, external NVM control? You know, in the previous slide you see, I mentioned, you know, a typical SoC design today, even with an integrated secure element, an external flash can be used, accessed by the secure element for security features, but it can also be accessible by the SOC CPUs directly for the application side. So one obvious thing to do is to let the secure element control all accesses to the flash, whether they are used for security or not. You know, that way you have a control that the SOC CPU, you know, will execute always code coming from the flash that has been authenticated. The boot control has even more advantage, and that's the main changes is basically, and you know, we are working on that with some customers who are already convinced on the use of secure element. The next step would be, okay, let's have this secure element be the first internal component to boot inside the SOC. Okay, so the CPU is not going to boot first and then decide later on to use a secure element. In that case, the secure element boots first and decide when to reset the SOC CPU. So the secure boot boots first. In that case, it's like a standalone secure element chip. With all the security, it will read the images from the flash, fills the code images from the flash, fills the RAM for the SOC processor of the image, and release the reset of the SOC processor, which means that it's the job of the secure element to retrieve the authenticated image of the code on which the CPU are going to boot. Basically, you might not need the ROM anymore. You have a ROM in the secure element to do the boot, and then, you know, charge from the flash the firmware for the CPU. So the secure boot in that case is fully handled by the ISE, you know, which gives much more control on and prevent malware be executed on the CPU that are introduced typically in external flash. Then we are working in the context of a project I mentioned in the beginning, the Grand Défi Cybersécurité IMRC project. I give you an introduction on that, on smart and adaptive object to better resist new cyber attacks. It's actually an extension of what I just mentioned. We want to make a secure element more active objects and leverage the connection to the network and potentially to a central server to detect new attacks, even attacks that are not known today, using some artificial intelligence techniques. Okay, so this is a research project. We collaborate with the CIA, CEA in French, the famous National French Research Center on this project. The goal is, phase one, is to make a secure element, turn it into IMRC. That is an active component for monitoring and recovering SOC application parts. Remember, we are still in this paradigm that in my SOC, I have two parts. I have the trusted system, which is my secure element, more or less, with its secure memories, encrypted memory. And I have the SOC, the rest of the SOC, the majority of the design, which is untrusted for the reason we mentioned already. What I want to make sure is that I can, my device, even if a malware is introduced in the untrusted part, that my SOC can always connect to the network and some control server, no matter what, okay? To apply techniques to detect new attacks. So that's what we do. It's a two-phase, I would say. You have two familiar functions. We monitor, and when we handle remote recovery. The IMRC, which is an extended secure element, will not only provide security functions to the SOC, but it will also monitor the SOC to detect malware and accidental deadlock. So you have two levels of monitoring. So what we're trying to see, to detect here in the SOC, are suspicious behaviors that could be the result of an attack or initiating an attack. Okay, so at the SOC level, we monitor directly in the SOC. We introduce some measurement inside the SOC. So there is a little bit of intrusion, small hardware to check some register, to check some buses. But just to retrieve some information to store in the secure element. So we look at the flash read-write pattern, at the power consumption. These are the kind of things we can look, the memory load, the network traffic. For example, there is no traffic anymore on the network. You know, it has been disconnected for some reason. And if we can, if we have the connection, we report anomaly to a central server. Okay, we'll see what we do if we cannot control in a moment. Then that's some anomalies that you know that we can classify as suspicious, I would say. But then we can also monitor more information and send more information to our central server that will help a central server to detect suspicious behavior of, for example, a fleet. Let's imagine you have a fleet of 1,000 objects for traffic light control, or 10,000 objects for, I don't know, industrial sensor in industrial site. Other application. Well, it might be interesting to know if the behavior of a node, of an object, is radically different now compared to the history. Or, for example, if among all your nodes, some nodes have a behavior that is completely different. You know, so the idea is that you can send this information. As the object is connected, you do that, you know, from time to time. You don't have a negative impact on the performance of the chip. And you report that to a central server that can apply then tactics. You have all probabilities. You can use AI techniques, to decide that, you know, if this is characteristic or not of an attack. And then how do you recover? So first case, as mentioned earlier, let's assume the IMRC notice that cannot communicate with the central server, which is typically the effect of a malware. Well, you can implement from the beginning in the IMRC that is always active and protected. You can implement the rules to decide to allow the IMRC to automatically reboot the SOC when the communication of the central server is not possible for some time. And when you do that, you can also make sure that it reboots on a recovery image that is saved. The communication is still not impossible. So by this mechanism, because you have this secure element that is at the control of the boot, you can make sure that the recovery is always possible, you know, even with a persistent malware on the application side, thanks to this secure boot fully handled by the secure element, by the IMRC. Okay. And then once you have the communication, what we will implement is to make sure that the central server will allow to remotely recover the infected nodes. Of course, when you have a fleet of objects that is deployed, it might be a nightmare economically and even might not be feasibly at all to change the firmware or of these nodes. So it's of importance here that we can always allow remote recovery. And this is ensured by the recovery power of the IMRC. The central server will also do some remote analysis of malware using AI techniques. And again, this is in order to be able to predict malware that are not known today. And of course, we use this channel to have a secure deployment of software updates. So this is the mission and the goal of the IMRC project. This is work in progress. It's progressing well. We are 1/3 of the project. But if you are interested and if you have questions, there is going to be a first demo on that with a domotic smart home application hosted by the CA at the LETI during the LETI Innovation Days. That's end of June, 22nd and 23rd. You will see the demo of the system in action. I know, and there will be place to ask technical questions you might want. And that's the end of my presentation. So thank you, everyone. If you have questions, I think we have time.
Thanks very much, Serge. That was super interesting. We have a few questions. So we have Damien from Hyperstone GmbH, who asks, hardware safebox versus cybersecurity, are they redundant or complementary?
Hardware safebox versus cybersecurity? I would say hardware safebox is one of the tools to allow cybersecurity. You know, it's part of a full cybersecurity solution. When you what we see is when you have objects that are connected to internet or mobile network, you need to implement end-to-end IoT security solution. Okay, so what we have detected today is more and more malwares on big infrastructure, you know, with firewalls and so on, comes from objects, from attacks on the objects that are kind of the weak spot on networks. So it means that you need absolutely to secure these objects and to introduce what we call these hardware secure elements. But of course, this is only to protect the objects and the network that is connected there. So you also need to have firewalls, you need to have software protection, but basically you need to have security everywhere.
Yeah, so you need to protect your hardware as well as your software.
Absolutely. Yeah, and okay, one additional comment I will make, of course, focus the idea of the speech on hardware security countermeasures, but even on a secure element, it's not enough. I mean, you need to have hardware security countermeasures, but you also need to have software security countermeasures. So it's really you are piling, you know, all the countermeasures. So the crypto library, for example, software crypto library that you provide, they run on a secure hardware with countermeasures, but they also include software countermeasures. So you always have a trade-off what to secure in the hardware and the software, including at all level. And then at the application level, when you have a banking payment application or whatever, you know, then also you introduce some security, but at this other level of communication, and you know, and it goes to up to the cloud. Of course, the access to the cloud must be protected, the server, the big server must be protected. So I would say hardware secure element protection of the objects, it's part of a rule of the cyber security strategy.
Okay. So Francis from EXEC, the question is that what Intel SGX do? I imagine he's asking whether you do the same job as Intel SGX. I'm not sure, Francis, if you want to specify a little bit more in the chat. I'm imagining that's what his question means. Do you do the same thing as Intel SGX? Yeah. Okay.
I'm not an expert on Intel SGX. But I would say, I mean, company like Intel, big companies, they have security experts, of course, and they do have a hardware enclave. It's not a yes and no answer here. You have indeed hardware security. You have some kind of security enclave, but then it depends on the level of certification you want to put. You know, I'm not sure, you know, for example, the certification level of Common Criteria 5+, this is something still rare, still present only in secure elements today. And you don't have that on system on chip because of history. But it's starting. So I would say, you know, you have difference more on the qualification on the security level you can have, depending on what kind of attacks you want to prevent, if it's only software attack, or if you want also to be able to address the physical attacks.
Okay, we have Pierre from Calray who asks, do you intend to integrate Watchdog into the IMRC?
I believe so. I encourage Pierre to contact us or the team, you know, to have a more technical answer to that.
Very mysterious. Okay.
The thing is, I don't want to appear mysterious, but first one, I'm not sure 100%. I don't want to say silly things. And as I said, this is work in progress. I know that both teams, we already have an impressive documentation where, okay, they listed all the kind of attacks, known attacks that you want to be able to prevent that. And they also listed all the kind of measurement countermeasures that are implemented in the IMRC. And these lists are evolving, of course. So, you know.
Threats are evolving. Okay, so watch this space. We have a question as well from Frederick from Advanced Group, who asks, now that more and more SOCs integrate secure enclaves, is there still a purpose for TPMs and associated protocols, such as TPM 2.0, apart from use cases where ICs do not integrate any security features?
So I missed some of the words you said. So I'm going to try to look at the...
Yeah, go into the question tab and it's in that one. Okay, it's in the question tab.
Yes. Oh, okay. TPM. Okay. So that's another story. TPM is a secure element. It's not at the same level or at system level. You know, TPM secure element today. They do not support OSs like Linux. You know, in my com, but. You might need more powerful secure element. It's not called a secure element in that case. It's called more, you know, TPM or similar devices. Secure element is really handling software. I mean, the example of software I gave, but not a full operating system. We are not at the same scale. So it's mainly used to implement security functions like the one I mentioned, or to implement security inside the SOC. There is still room to be able to improve the security for basically the main CPU that required to secure the complete OS system. You know? So this is not called secure element for the moment. And the other comment I would say is, unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, because it means that we have still more business to do, but it's still a minority of the SOC today that integrate secure elements. So it's, I mean, the trend has started I guess Qualcomm was, for example, the first company 1 or 2 years ago of having a SOC integrating a secure element implementing the iSIM features. Other companies are following, but it's still relatively new.
So the world domination is still underway.
It's, but again, you know, there, and you have to be careful about the names you use at the end. You know, okay, if you have a TPM, okay, do you want it to be protected against physical attacks, for example? Do you want to go for Common Criterial 5 Plus certification? Okay, my knowledge. From what I know, but I might be wrong, I don't think we are that yet. And on the other end, secure elements come from the smart cards, so they are becoming more and more powerful. You know, now you have new secure elements, we're using RISC-V architecture, so the trend is indeed to augment the computing power of a secure element, but we are not that at the level of...
We're not there yet.
Exactly. And you know, and then you know, some technologies from the secure element will most probably be integrated inside in the main processor of over larger systems.
Okay, I think we've gone through all the questions. I'll leave you a minute longer to see if anyone else has any last minute burning questions for Serge. Doesn't look like it. Okay, so thank you very much, Serge, for this excellent speech. Very interesting, very informative. And thank you all for your participation. It's great having you being actively involved. And join us for the rest of the afternoon conferences. We've now moved on to the international side of our conferences. As I said, Serge is also participating in the Silicon Saxony Day event today, which is our partners event. And then we have this afternoon coming up, we have Chris Meadows, we have Duncan Stewart, and we have Bernie Brennan, who are going to be talking about security in English again for the afternoon conferences. So thank you very much, Serge. And
thank you, Kate. Thank you, everyone, for your time. Bye-bye.
Thank you.